Tigrayur, I mean, around this spurious, I mean, we drew circles around the spurious poles and there were these sea tilde contours. So you said, I mean, we can treat them as a contour integrals here, but in general they are two-dimensional integrals.
Yeah, so you started with integral d to y. We had to deal with integral d to y. But the integral is called this del y, I think we have to call it phi, right? Or del y bar of phi. Then you said, as long as phi is independent of y and y bar, this is it, integral is it, right? And this you can do for most of the space except around this subcontour, around the spurious poles. So inside the spurious pole, we will choose the insertion to be constant, y independent. Outside, we will choose it to be y independent. But there, of course, you have to take, well, let me know the integral vanishes everywhere, except that because of this vertical jump here, we have to integrate over a subspace, right? Over a subspace, which is this times the vertical direction. Right? And that integration over vertical direction we are already seen gives this I of V minus I of. That's the reason why in this case it became a one less absolute. Yeah, because whenever you have a vertical section, right, it always reduces the dimension of the moduli space. In the moduli space, normally you have to integrate over a section and the dimension of the section is the same as the dimension of the moduli space. Right? But whenever you have a vertical segment, right, that eats up one dimension. Right? And hence, in the moduli space, you have to integrate over one less dimension. And that's how you become a complete. Is this other questions?
We also said the action for ghost field. I mean,
yes.
They don't know about what background we are on.
That's right. Yes.
So it means that their action is also constant, or it can change.
The ghost action is independent on the background. Yeah. The ghost field is always P, right? So when you write down the white slip theory, there is a ghost part which is always a free action, universal for all background, right? It will change of course when you go from heterotic to type 2. But for the heterotic, the ghost action is fixed and universal. The only part that knows about the background is a macro part. Okay, so last time then you calculated two-point function. Okay, and that two-point function that you calculated was relevant for testing whether supersymmetry is broken or not. Okay, that was a direct test of supersymmetry breaking. So today we will calculate another two-point function which is also related to supersymmetry breaking. Okay, but this will be an indirect test. Okay, based on the low energy field. And so let me remind you that we had this D-term potential, the general form, the D-term potential that we wrote down. Was 1 over G square. Okay, this is of course universal, you don't, you multiply also a kinetic term. Then you had a half, 2i, ii star ii, plus G square. Okay, these are the D-term potential. And non-zero C implies that 2C is broken at part of the time. Okay, and you can also see from here because water weight factor is when all the phi i's are zero, and non zero C will generate a vacuum energy density, which is a signal that supersymmetry is broken. But we can also see that non zero C has other signatures. If not, C is non zero, this means, so C not equal to zero, means that phi i has square given by qi c gs square. Okay, and the fact that gs square, that is gs square, this means that it's generated one way. Okay, so this we see, that's why expanding it in parts is in phi and picking up a quadratic piece in phi. Okay, so when you expand out the square, you get a term from gs square c qi phi I star phi n. And that's what shows that phi I acquires a one loop mass renormalization. This 1 over gs square is relevant, irrelevant, because 1 over gs square also multiplies the phi I hat. Right? There is 1 over gs square times l nu phi I l nu phi. So that you can just factor out. So this is one loop. So one way to test if C is 0 or non-zero is to see if charge fields, if fields which are charged under the C1, yeah, which are massless at the tree level, generate, acquire a one loop mass square. Okay, that will be a test if C is 0 or non-zero. Okay. And this is also important because if we could calculate the mass square unambiguously, then it will also tell us the sign of the mass square. So in particular, from this equation, you can see that if C over QI is less than 0, then there exists squeezy vacuum at mod phi I minus C over QI times Cs, provided phi I has no other A. So determining the sign of C is also important. And by correlating this with this, we see that C over QI naught less than 0 would mean that the mass square is negative. Right? If C over QI is less than 0, QIC is also less than 0. So the mass square is negative. Okay? So phi I should acquire a tachyonic mass square. And that essentially signals that the vacuum, that the quadratic vacuum becomes unstable at one loop. That it develops tachyonic reaction. So what was earlier the minimum of the potential now becomes the maximum of the potential. And there is a real by minimum where supersymmetry is S2. So based on one loop calculus, you know, the renormalized mass square, one can in principle figure out whether there is a real by supersymmetry tachyon. Okay. If one is willing to use this insight from low energy effective action. Okay. Otherwise, okay, you have to do a direct analysis in string field theory to check if there is any other supersymmetry. Right? That's also in principle possible. Okay, and we'll discuss that maybe tomorrow. But today we'll focus on calculating this mass square. Okay? Mass square one. Is this clear?
Sir, should there be that Gs square in the mass square? Because when we
Yes. If you expand it out, the mass square is m square phi I square phi I, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So you have qi times gs square times c.
Yes, but there is a gs square.
But this one, what I said is that the kinetic term is also multiplied by this 1 over gs square.
Okay.
Right? So this 1 over gs square you can factor out. Right? Or you can say that you will absorb this gs square inside the normalization of phi I.
Okay.
But the kinetic term and the mass term is normalized in the same way. Right? So that will basically get back to gs. So 1 over gs square is not very relevant because the kinetic term also gets multiplied by the same. Okay. Now, one loop mass renormalization is not very hard to calculate. You don't need the full power of optional string theory because one loop renormalized mass is obtained by just calculating a 2-point function at one loop with all shell external states. Right? It's only when we are trying to go beyond that, that we have to really resort to off-shell formalism because there will be divergences. See, the kind of divergences that we encounter, that we normally would encounter in all shell formalism is this, that if we draw set k square equal to m square, k square plus m square equal to 0, then this will diverge, right? What k square plus m square will be infinite. So you really have to watch to calculate Friedmann-Mayer's mass beyond 1, 2. But this, of course, never appears at 1, right? This is a 2 loop. At 1 loop, you are only interested in this, okay, or other graphs of this kind, all are 1, right? And there, it's enough to set k square plus m square equal to 0. This is a 3-level mass. And let's compute this two. Okay, so you don't need full optional formalism for doing this calculation. Is this clear? So we'll focus on the scalar which is a singlet of SO 26 and carry U1 charge. Okay, because you are good that for that singlet there are no other neutrons because it's a singlet of SO 26, so only U1 neutron involves that field. And there is no other F star either, then simply by charge conversion. Okay, we have an argument that this kind of scalar will have no other term in the potential, okay, which would spoil giving it magnitude. So this is a scalar issue. Because you can see that if C over QI is negative, right, then when you set mod phi I equal to minus square root of C over QI times CS, this term vanishes, right? So that gives you 0 energy.
Okay, so see that the fact that it has a normalized mass, that indicates some negative.
No, the fact that it has normalized mass means that the supersymmetry is located in the part of it. That's always true. The quantum vacuum, this phi I equal to 0, will clearly have a non-zero energy density and then supersymmetry will broken. Okay. Now the question is whether there is a nearby vacuum where supersymmetry is restored.
So that can be a quantum
vacuum. That will not be a quantum vacuum because of shift field. Okay. So that exists only if this condition is satisfied. Okay. Whether supersymmetry is broken in the quantum vacuum, that is only determined by whether C is 0 or not. So these are two independent issues, right? But in practical terms, all the models that are known, right, has this feature that whenever supersymmetry is broken at the bottom of the vacuum, right, there always seems to be a nearby vacuum where supersymmetry is restored. Right? So I don't think anybody has found an example so far where supersymmetry is actually broken. Right? Namely, this is possible. Okay, but that's a general. Okay, one could find in principle models of. So you basically have to calculate the two power function of phi I star, right? So phi I star, two power function on torus. So the first thing we have to do is to construct a vortex operator for phi and phi star. So let me write down the general structure of the vortex operator. These are scalars. So the general structure of the vortex operator will be C bar C e to the minus phi P call it just D. Well, this is a matter sector primary, matter sector. One half. Okay, one in the anti-holomorphic sector and half in the holomorphic sector. So that combines with the dimension 0 half, which this one has, it will be minus 5 to give a dimension 1 half. So this is the modulus of order for 5. And I should also put this into the IK dot x. So this is basically the matter sector from CFT. Okay, because this wouldn't have a Lorentz index. So of course one can in principle construct some vortex of order without Lorentz index, okay, even in terms of the non-compact directions like del x2, del x2. But those are real ones, right? So those you understand. We are talking about those fields because those in particular can only one charge anyway. Okay. So this vortex of order has to come from the intersection. And the vortex of order for phi star. Phi star will be C bar C to the minus phi. Let me call this V star to the minus I to the x. Okay, we'll take this to have momentum k, this to have momentum minus k. And V star is again the same. Matter sector vortex of order, dimension 1 half. This is a conjugate of order. Now this analysis can be done without referring to any specific conformal field theory till the very end. But let me just give an example, okay, which will make it clear what kind of operator we are dealing with. Okay. So last time, if you remember, we discussed this Z3 auto Ford model. Okay, first consider a torus compact, right? So for a torus compactification, of course it has not a supersymmetry, right? It's not n equal to 1 supersymmetry. Okay? But you can certainly embed n equal to 1 supersymmetry inside torus. Okay? And typically one way to get an n equal to 1 supersymmetry theory from torus compactification is to take all two folds. Which basically means that you take the 6 internal coordinates, make them into complex coordinates, okay, x1, x4 plus ix5, x6 plus ix7 and x8 plus ix9. And then we can project out by Z3 symmetry that just changes the phi of each of these complex coordinates by equal to pi I by 3. And that's all you have to then construct around. And you will do the same thing for the formulas. So let me write down some example. The ordinary form models, what are the form of the analysis? Here we are talking about the Z3. So there, P goes as IM okay, I call these formulas lambda bar or lambda last time when the formulas which come from the left moving center. Right, when I describe it, it's not a quantum theory. Okay. These are anti-Hall perfect. Okay. That's why I use lambda bar, but I don't remember what I use. I thought lambda. Okay, so lambda. Okay, this is I moving this level. Okay, and this index m, p, q are the complex indices, right? These are about 3 values. Okay, because they are combined by the one complex coordinates. So these are the space-time indices on this side. These are actually gauge indices, right? Of this 32 gauge indices, but we have divided the 32 into 26. Which do not appear here, and the 6 we have combined into complex operations. Okay? That's the idea of embedding spin correction into gauge correction. Right? We are treating the left movers as if they have a space time transformation law, even though they are completely independent. So, in this way, these are complex, three dimensions, these take values, these also get 3 values, and we construct an SU3 invariant combination by constructing. Contact from the epsilon. and V star in this notation will be psi m bar, lambda q bar, lambda q bar. They are the complex conjugate indices, epsilon m bar. Okay, these are asked to keep in mind an example of some order software like this. Now, one thing you can see is that these do not carry any SO6 index, right? Because SO6 index is carried by the lambdas, which are not the ones trapped there, right? This is six, three complex lambdas, which are the six. Which came from the six real lambdas, which are part of the SO6. The SO26, okay, is the rest of the indices, but those indices are not carried by the stars, right? That's the reason why these are SO26 again. Is that clear? That's what you want. And U1 charge 2, okay, why it doesn't have U1 charge 2? Can anybody see that this is U1 charge 2? The U1 charge will be carried by these complex lambdas, right? Lambdas with holomorphic index carries U1 charge plus 1. Lambda with anti-holomorphic index will carry U1 charge minus 1, right? Because that U1 is coming from inside SO6. So these are two lambdas with holomorphic index, right? That's why it has U1 charge 2. These are two lambdas with anti-holomorphic index, so this is conjugate state U1 charge minus 2. Okay. If you have single lambdas, then you have U1 charge 1. Okay, so for example, I could have constructed another class of states where it's lambda p and lambda I, where I is one of those 26. Okay, that would have been a perfectly acceptable order subordinate. But those will describe massless states which carry U1 charge 1 and they are singlets of S26. In fact, okay, I couldn't have replace this by one single one, that would not be SU3 singlet, but what I could do is psi m lambda m bar lambda I. Right? So these will have, this is SU3 singlet. So this is the good vortex operator, it survives all input projection. This will have U1 chart minus 1 because it carries a bar index. And this will be an associate 26. 26 also 26. Is that clear? Okay, but you are not going to consider those vortex operators because those are charged under U1. They will have additional D transformation, right? So you can't really give the back transfer. Okay, but if you want to calculate the spectrum of the theory, you have to include.
States are not singlet because of this I.
Yeah, these states are not singlet because of this I. Right? Yeah,
because so you cannot find some invariant tensor that combines the same indices.
Yes, you could try to construct, for example, psi m lambda I lambda I. Right? Contract the two lambda i's, right, appropriately, or lambda I lambda j. I don't see. You want SO26 singlet, right? I think if you have, because it's an anti-symmetric in the two lambdas, I think there are probably no SO26 singlets you can construct out of the lambdas. Right? But you can certainly construct other representations, lambda I lambda j, for example. Right? Anti-symmetric. That will be some other representation, anti-symmetric representation of SO26. Right? So those also are perfectly possible. But you want something which will be charged under U1 and SO26 singlet. Right? And I think for that, this is only candidate, at least for this class. How is it?
How is the value fixed? You mentioned it earlier.
Yeah, we just fix lambda carrying U1 charge 1. Right? Then because it has two lambdas.
No, but why does this vortex operator have charge 2? That is somewhat earlier lecture.
Yeah, so the one is generically, this is orbital model. There you can explicitly see that there is a vortex operator of this kind. But for a generic compactification, right, that's why it's from studying the generic properties of the general properties of conformal field theory, and the property of the supersymmetry algebra, take these two algebra. One can show that there will always be a monic supporter with this property. Okay? If you have a left hand symmetric model, there will always be a monic supporter, which will be singular of S26 and there is no other. But I think if you don't consider left hand symmetric models, then this is no longer. But for left hand symmetric models, upon you can study spectrum on the right hand side, on the right sector, which has genuine supersymmetry. And because of the left hand symmetry, that implies something about the spectrum on the left sector. Yeah, and using that, you can show there will always be some of the yeah, so there is general safety based on. Okay, so we are calculating 2 to 1/5. So we have to choose local coordinate system appropriately so that we write down the integration measure. And we will choose this coordinate system in exactly the same way that we did last time. So let me remind you what we did last time. We broke up the totals. So this is our origin, 0. So these are the locations for the punctures. So this is C1, this is C2, this is C3, C4. Our global coordinate in U, which is U plus 1, U plus tau. And the coordinate systems are W1, W2, W3, W4. So W1 is U, W2 is U minus Y, W3 is U, and W4 is U minus Y. Okay, this is what we chose last time, and that's exactly what we'll choose this time. So you don't have to rework out the integration measure again. But there is one difference from last time. Last time we had two vortex operators in a minus R picture. We are talking about two Ramon sector vortex operators. This time we have two LA sector vortex operators. So they are in minus one picture. Okay. And because of this, we now need two picture changing operators. Right? We are told us we have to have total picture number 0. So two vortex operators, each of picture number minus one. So we need two PCOs. So two PCOs and let's say V1 and V2. Strict field theory, or more generally the factorization, tells us give some constraint on these PCOs. So what is the constraint? Okay, in the degeneration limit, as y goes to 0, which means a degeneration of this type. Then a sphere joined to the torus by a long angle. These are the punctures 0 and y. So what do we need? We need that the state that propagates through this is minus 1 picture. Okay. So this is minus 1, this is minus 1. We need minus 1 state to propagate here. So this is minus 1, this is minus 1, this is minus 1, this is minus 1. And now you can see how the PCO should be inserted. So one PCO should be here. And one PCO should be here. Okay, because here altogether there are minus 3. Okay, so here one of the PCOs must appear here, and here there is minus 1 on the torus. So you should be one PCO here. So this is a factorizing partition. Okay. that this is in string field theory, it's automatic. If you don't want to use string field theory, then this is something that I have postulated, that this is the way we factorize. Is this clear? So there is one way to implement this, okay, and that's what we are going to use, okay, although it's certainly not necessary. One way to implement this is that to choose V2 equal to Y. And V1 away from 0. Always.
Sorry, this is the 0 and Y could be also on this right hand side, right? Then
well, the point is that then it's not a degeneration, because to have a degeneration you need at least 3 boundaries here. See, if it's if 0 and 1 come on the borders, right? Then this becomes a one bound sphere, right? That's not degeneration, because on the sphere there is no one bound function.
It is 0.
It is 0, yeah. So whenever you talk about degeneration, you always ensure that on the sphere you have at least 3.
You will get a non vanishing answer.
Exactly. To get a non vanishing degeneration, if it vanishes, of course, then there is a constant, yeah. Okay, that's why you cannot even have one puncture here, one puncture there, right? Because that's also going to vanish, because you get two punctures. Okay, so let me repeat again. So if we choose V2 equal to Y and V1 equal not equal to 0, then it guarantees that whenever Y comes close to 0, one PCO is close to the both the punctures, the other PCO is always added from the punctures. Is that clear? Yeah, because that's what we need for reactivation. So this one PCO which is supposed to be here, we basically put on top of Y always. Okay, it doesn't destroy any other degenerations that you can have, right? So you can easily check. Okay, so you can make a answer so answer for all that one of the PCOs you put on Y. Okay, but the other ones will be kept away from zero. This is not what normally people would use. Normally when you have to calculate a torus 2 point function, right, it's a common practice to just use 0 picture vortex operator. Right? Because 0 picture vortex operator would mean that you put one PCO on this, one PCO on this, and be done. Right? Because then that just changes picture from 0 to minus 1 to 0. Right? And then you would try to do your calculation. Right? But you see that if you do that, then that's incompatible with the degeneration. Because if you use 2 0 picture vortex operator, that means that you are putting 2 PCOs on this. Right? Because one is on this, one is on this. Right? So in the degeneration limit, 2 are on this, none are on this side. Right? And then the state that is propagating here is not a minus 1 picture state. Right? And that's certainly not compatible with string field theory. Right? And you use, don't use string field theory, but use a general rule that of degeneration is not compatible.
Yes. We encountered this problem in choosing a section without spurious forces like that. How will we encounter this
problem? We will not encounter this problem. We will just see, we will get results which are, for example, incompatible effective field theory analysis. Okay. See, if you don't use string field theory, then there is no reason why the low energy limit of that should be compatible with any effective field theory. Okay, and you will find that you will not, you will get results which cannot be interpreted as a field theory answer. Yeah, so for sensible theory, you have to use at least guidance from string field theory, right? Even if you don't directly use string field theory. Here, for example, you don't need the full theory of string field theory because you are doing an on-cell calculation, right? Nevertheless, this insight from string field theory you have to use. Okay, and we'll see that we'll make a mistake if you don't use this insight.
Sorry, why string field theory should know about low energy effective theory and not the first quantized theory?
Because string field theory, at least you can imagine that if you start with string field theory and integrate all the heavy fields, you should get a field theory involving massless fields, right? So, in essence, by construction, string field theory should reduce to some effective field theory. If you don't use string field theory but just use wall shape theory, then in general, no one tells you that you should have correct properties, right? All the factorization properties, etc., may not work in that case. So let me describe the strategy that we'll be using to do this calculation. Of course, there are various other strategies you can use. So what we'll do is that first we'll do a wrong calculation. Okay, we'll do a wrong calculation by putting one PC on this, one PC on that. That's what someone normally want to do, two 0 PC parts. And then we'll simply answer is 0. Okay, but there are other reasons that you can use to see that this is incompatible. In particular, if the answer is 0, then beta does not decay. So everything supersymmetry is unbroken in the quantum ready vacuum. But on the other hand, just from low energy analysis, you can see that the U1 gauge theory actually is anomalous. Okay. So something has to happen, okay, to repair that. Okay. One way you could repair that is possibly generating a beta. Okay. It's not obvious, but you can show that once you generate a beta, then various things happen. U1 gauge will also eventually become positive and you get rid of this anomalous problem. But if you don't generate the beta, then there will be a mutual incompatibility between the fact that there is a U1 anomaly and everything seems to be fine otherwise. Okay? So that is a signal that there is a problem. But otherwise you could have said, okay, that's the right answer. Okay? Take 2-0 picture, what is required, do your calculation and be done with it. So we'll do this calculation of 2-0 picture, what is required. Okay? Okay, we'll see that the result is 0. And then we'll calculate the correct one, okay, with one PCO away from 0. But instead of calculating that directly, we'll find it easier to calculate the difference. Okay, the difference between the correct answer and the wrong answer, which you know is 0. Okay, and the difference is easier to calculate because that can be shown to be total derivative. Okay, you will only pick a boundary. Okay, so it makes it easier. Whenever the wrong answer is 0, then it makes it easier for us to calculate the right answer because the difference between the right and the wrong answer is typically total derivative. Okay, because the difference between the right and wrong answer is that you are shifting the PCO, right? Okay, that gives total derivative. Is that the total derivative doesn't give 0 at the boundary level, for instance. So that's the way we try to set up the calculation. Right? We first show that the wrong approach gives 0 answer. Yeah, then we will see, you calculate the difference between the right procedure and the wrong procedure. Okay. So the general form, even before you choose anything, this is the form of the method. Okay, here I have used a bit more compact notation. Okay. Written as an exponential, but you really have to think of this as an expansion. Okay. 1 over n factorial times dk dx k to the power n. Okay, that expansion I just wrote as an exponential, which sin of 1 minus dxi. Because you need beta O, it's beta of R, it's dy, it's dy. Okay. Four dimensions, etc. Oh, I should have put the body subparts also. Okay, so let me remind you again that this is the body operator C bar C to the minus 5. B
3 r cube dot x, and this is sigma c to minus pi v star minus. So the first step is our non-controversial. So this is, we want to put 1 over PCO at y. Okay, v2 equal to y. So we have to choose v2 equal to y. Okay. So let me remind you that here we have y, then we have the circle C2 outside. This coordinate system is W2, this coordinate system is W3, and we have W3 equal to W2 plus 1. Because W3 is u, W2 is u minus 1. And so this is the relation. This is clear? So now you see that there are two ways you can take the limit. Yeah, both should give the same result. Okay. This is something I want to illustrate here. Okay. This is a general feature which shows the robustness of this formula, but I will take this example to illustrate this. Okay. So what are the two ways you can take a V2 goes to y? One is that you insert it in here, inside this circle. Okay. Insert it here and then take V2 goes to y limit. Then do whatever integral you have to do about C. Okay, that's one possible way. The other way is to insert V2 outside. Okay, and then do this integral. Okay, and then take the limit V2 goes to y. These two apparently start as different expressions, okay, but nevertheless, at the end, you will see that they are the same. Is the difference between the two clear? One is that you insert V2 in this coordinate system, okay, do this calculation, then do this integral. Other one is that insert V2 outside, do this integral, and then V2 goes to 0. Okay? So let us calculate the difference between these two procedures. So let me just indicate how this goes. So suppose you take V2 to be inside. V2 to be inside. Then you have to measure V2 in the W2 coordinate system. Okay? So in the W2 coordinate system, setting V2 equal to y means setting W2 equal to 0. So its coordinate is 0. Okay. So V2 essentially is 0 in the W2 coordinate system. So that means that the delta V2 is, this term doesn't contribute, it's a 0.
Is W2 here writing as V2 minus y here?
W2 is u minus y. Then u is a global coordinate system. So when you set V2 equal to y, that corresponds to setting V2 equal to 0 if you use W2 coordinate system. Right? And if you are inserting V2 inside the C2, then you are instructed to use the W2 coordinate system to level the coordinates on it. Right? So V2 is 0 in that description. So these terms will be disappears. Is that part clear? So in that notation, what you will have is just chi of y
u. Because dx, delta V2 is essentially dV2. And V2 is.
Exactly.
you mean delta of v2, v2 doesn't depend on any other modulus. See, this dx is sum over j answer for tau tau bar y y bar, right? And if v2 is 0, that means it's not depending on either tau tau bar or y y bar, because in the double two coordinate system, right, the coordinate of v2 doesn't depend on anything. So the derivative will be 0. Okay? This LJ V2 will be 0. Is that clear? So you have to calculate chi y v and then do whatever integral you have to do over c. Okay? That's this D part. Which is something from V2. Okay? Let me say add something else just to simplify things, but it's not necessary here. We'll take to be v1 to be y independent. V1 to be independent of y1. The last time we saw there could be possible issue because of the spurious pulse. Okay. Here in fact we'll see that there are no problems. You can set v1 to be some constant independent of y and alpha. Look at these from here also. Right? The dy del y v1 and dy bar del y bar v1, these terms vanish. So let us go ahead and do this calculation. Then we will come back to the other possibilities that v2 is inserted outside. You first do the b integral and then get the okay, we'll see that they actually give the same result. Okay, and let me just indicate how they will give the same result. See, the point when you are outside, right, then this is no longer 0. Right? Because ultimately then when you try to set vt equal to y, the del y v2 term will contribute, right? Okay, v2 coordinate system, y order that you try to set v2 eventually, right, is not independent of y because you have inserted v2 in the W3 coordinate system. Is that clear? But then you can rewrite that insertion as V2 inserted somewhere inside, and then the contour integral of this around the point V. Okay? Because it's like if you have this minus V2 inserted inside, the difference is given by the contour integral of this contour integral around V. Okay. And basically, we will see that exactly compensates for this fact that here you have a del V2. Okay. In the other case, you didn't have a del. But let's worry about that later. Let me just proceed with this presentation. Okay. That V2 is inside C2, so you will just have chi y. Okay. And see what result will get. Now chi y, let me remind you of this p del psi plus p phi df minus 1 quarter del theta p phi minus 1 quarter del theta also has a form of picture changing operator that I have written down somewhere. DF is the matter sector superstress tensor. And for our purpose, we'll need the OP, EF from Z, P sigma star from W. This goes as minus the environment from U equals PP minus sigma star. Where this is a dimension 1 of R. This is in fact what normally appears in the zero picture part. Just the OP of E of Z, D sigma star W, gives you
the
energy.
Pardon?
Sigma
what?
Right, E star. So, in the orbifold example, let me say what this is. Star is orbifold example. There, we build the star essentially goes as del xm bar basically earlier it was psi m bar.
V1 was a primary but not a super conformal primary.
Because you basically are applying a G minus 3 half on the state, right? To create this. You have G minus half on the state to create this. That's why it's a second rank. As far as the super conformal algebra is
concerned.
So P with V star, if you pick the Z minus of the inverse term, that basically is here. Because you are increasing the dimension by half. Right? You start the dimension 1 half and then go to dimension 1 half. Then you are increasing the dimension by half. Is this okay? So this is P. The other OP is you can work out explicitly because TF also has a psi mu del x mu part, right? The part that involves the non-compact bosons and formulas. So that part psi mu del x mu when you apply take the product into the ik dot x. That picks up also some additional singular terms. Right? P with into the ik dot x, right? The psi mu del x mu would into the ik dot x will give you something proportional into ik mu over x at minus 1. Right? So those things you can work out explicitly. So let me write down the final result. Here the reason that you can take the picture changing operator on top of the vortex operator is because there are no divergences in the OP. Okay? Okay, otherwise the correct procedure will happen to keep it active from the power circle. So you get C dot C V T dot star plus I dot 2 K dot psi V star V dot psi X minus all of these are so this part comes from the equity phi Tf of chi. Chi has many pieces, right? Equity phi Tf gives you this part. And this part comes from the last two parts. Okay, it's just straightforward gap of code. Be a little careful and take the OP. Okay? Because what does it involve, right? In the last two terms, for example, you know all the OP, right? Because these are pure ghosts, right? So the matter piece just pure sound as sort of this stuff. The matter piece just remains as it is. So the only thing I have to do is take the part OP of these. The ghost parts that is in there in the new star, right? In the new star. In new star, if you remember, had new star had c bar c to the minus phi times b, right? So the c bar c to the minus phi, right? Well, take the OP of this with this, okay, you get back. And that's why the eta has appeared in that sense. And because of the eta. Okay? This part doesn't contribute because the C with C gives you a 0. Right? And there's nothing to compensate for it. Because the first one doesn't contribute. Is this good? So what we did, this part I have left intact, this part I have left intact. Here we used first of all that from the chi of V2 minus that delta V2 term doesn't contribute because V2 is 0. Okay, in the W2 coordinate system we have taken already the limit chi y times nu star of y, and that expansion is given here. This whole state, whole thing is to be inserted. Okay, and then there is a mu of 0 which you have not touched so far. Is this clear? Now you see, we are assuming then, this is an extra assumption that we had written there, that V1 is y bar independent. Okay. So this term gives you a d tau and a d tau bar, but no dy and dy bar. Okay? But we want an integration measure which has d tau is d tau bar, or is dy, or is dy bar. Okay. So you have to get dy and dy bar from somewhere. And the only way to get that dy and dy bar is by expanding this out and pick up the by dy with dy bar dy bar. Right? So I can rewrite this as exponential tau, let's leave as it is, b tau plus b tau bar. Then that is there as usual, then the chi v1 minus chi v1 minus here is delta v1 delta v1 d tau plus the corresponding tau goes to tau bar. So all this is there. Then we have to have a v1 bar, then this object v of 0. And then you have pulled out the dy with dy bar. Okay, so now you only have to worry about the theta with theta bar contribution from here. But dy with dy bar you have explicitly evaluated, and they require that you have a dy and dy bar. Is this clear? Dy is dy bar. I'm not worried about the size, right? Basically, you have a dy dy, where is dy bar dy bar, right? So, dy is dy bar, I have explicitly pulled out, right? I still have to pull out the d tau is d tau bar from there because you have to integrate over tau bar, y and y bar, right? That I've left as it is inside, but the point to emphasize, point I'm trying to emphasize is in order to get the dy is dy bar part. The only way to get it from the dy and dy. Okay. So you just expanded out the exponential, that part of the exponential, and picked up dy, dy, what? Dy was dy. Is but what is dy? Dy. Well, you can say the minus integral over C2 BU dU and DY bar similar to minus integral over C2 BU bar dU. Right, that was the definition of DY and DY bar. C2 was a component of Y. So unless when you substitute this inside the correlation function, unless B of U has a pole at U equal to Y, this contribution vanishes. And so you have to pick only those terms which are poles at U equal to Y. Similarly, this has two have polar u bar equal to I bar. Is clear? Okay, otherwise these integrals will vanish, right? Inside the polar zone. Now let's look at the first one. Okay, this is inside the Y. When you insert this first term, will there be a pole at U equal to I? Yeah, BCOP has 1 bar U minus Y, right? So there will be a pole at U equal to I. What about at U bar equal to I bar? So that's C bar is there, right? So B bar, C bar will have a pole, 1 bar U bar, 1 bar U bar minus Y bar. So basically, BI, BI bar insertion will just remove this, right? And give a non-zero answer. And again, forgetting about 2 pi factors, etc. You get a non-zero answer with this remove. Now let's look at the second term. BU has a pole because again there is a C. Right? At E equal to C, there is 1 over U minus. Right? But B bar U bar has no pole. Well, B bar has one. There is no C bar there, right? From this. So because of this, effectively what one finds, actually I am letting one too. This may be C bar. Yeah, actually because this is C bar, so it's the other way. See, C bar, nothing ever happens to C bar, right? Because this guy has only holomorphic properties.
So B and C will be
in this. So B bar, C, so let me explain this again, right? I mean, you could have seen that there is something wrong because nothing can remove C bar. When you take the product chi u, chi y with nu y, right? Nu already had a C bar. Right? There is nothing that can get rid of the C bar, right? Because chi only has holomorphic pieces, so the C bar should be there. Okay? But the C is removed because you have to pick up the OP with this P. So in any case, the result is the same. The B will not have any poles. B bar will have a pole, but B has no pole. So the U integral will make a sign. So this simplifies this. So then the integral takes a form exponential b tau b tau plus b tau bar. Then chi of U1 minus b tau b1 b tau b tau bar. In fact, eventually we will also get rid of these, but they could be on tau independent in the appropriate coordinate system. For now, let's do it. And then we have x0 Well, inside a correlation function, it doesn't really matter because there's no contour integral or anything. Right? This is commutative. Right? U0 has host number 2. So, where you place it, it doesn't really matter. But it's understood that it's okay. Now, there's not even any contour integral, so there's nothing to specify. Okay, inside a correlation function, the position actually doesn't matter. Right? Actually, we should. Remember, the only thing that matters is if there is a contour integral, then whether the contour is enclosing that point or not enclosing that point, right? That you have to keep track of. And if there are anti-commuting, if there are all ghost number fields, then there is possible minus position coefficients. Okay, so this is the expression that we'll be analyzing. Okay, but I'll just leave this aside for a while. Okay, and discuss what happens if you have taken this G2 to be outside of it. Yeah, that's the other way. Okay. Because you want to see that you have gotten the same answer.
By taking v1 independent of y, y1,
yes,
are we satisfying this function?
Yes, because v1 has to be away from 0, that's what it is. So put v1 in a fixed position, away from y, y1. Okay? That will satisfy the de-energy function. The de-energy function. Okay? See, it doesn't matter if y hits v1, right? If both PCOs are on top of y, okay, it still is okay. Okay? Because that's not the de-energy function. So suppose V2 is inserted in W3 vortex. The W3 coordinate system, so this is W2, this is W3. So the palm size is W3 equal to Y. So you insert, this is our view. Okay, eventually we will take V2 to our square. Then we have to include the second term. So IY minus, we have to include this one, LY V2, LZ V2, VY. Because eventually, we'll have to set V2 equal to Y, right? And in the W3 coordinate system, V2 is Y, right? Because the coordinate of V2 is Y. So del Y V2 is certainly non-zero. Is that clear? Okay? But the difference is that now the integral that you have to insert, any integral that you insert here, the BY integral, will be the V2 will be outside this. So you have exponential. Let's work with the BY divided by. Okay, the BY bar is just works exactly in the same way. Right? So you don't have to worry about that. So if you expand it out, you get two terms. One is chi y, sorry, chi v2, let me write v2 like that. This is one way to get a term of y. The other way is to get minus del y v2, del xi v2. Earlier you have said that you have to pick the BY DY, right? When chi V2, when V2 was inside, right? This term was not there. And the only way you could get a term proportional DY is to pick up the BY. Okay? But now there is a possibility that you could get the DY from there.
The identity part.
Pardon? The identity part from here. Yes, identity part from here. Okay? DY bar will be have to be supplied by dy by dy, right? Because this doesn't have del y bar v2 is still 0, right? So set v2 for y. So now this you have to compare with what we had earlier. So now what you can do is to compare it to what we had earlier. This means that the chi is inserted outside this dy, right? Dy is this quantity. So let's just move v2 inside. Okay? And at the same time, add a term that is a residue. So what is the difference between inserting V2 outside and inserting V2 inside? So for the C, as far as CFD is concerned, right? You are just picking up the residue at V2, right? So I can write this as dy by V2. Dy you can write it. Plus there is a U, right? Which means that you have to pick up the possible pole that you have. So what is the residue? Thus, let me write the integral for V2, VU, VU, IV2. Is this clear what this means? Right, that you have to integrate the VU contour around V2. Right, because that's the difference between inserting V2 outside and inserting V2 inside. Okay, you just wrap the contour around this. So to calculate this, okay, you need a pole at U equal to V2, right, to get a non-zero answer. That means you need to pick from chi the part that has a C, because B has pole only at C, right? So which part of chi has C?
The first one.
If you look at the expression for chi, right, then the C del Z. So that's the only source of our possible pole in U. So this just gives you del Z of U. But just the entire of U. The C is gone because you have to be the residue for the BC of U. And now you see that when you say V2 equal to Y, these two terms exactly cancel. Right? This is the entire of Y. And you will accept it equal to Y. At V2 equal to Y, this is just 1, this is del xi of Y. So there is exact cancellation between these two terms. Okay, so whether you use the W3 coordinate system to insert chi or W2 coordinate system to insert chi, at the end you get exactly the same answer. So this tells us that you first take out B of chi, because already chi has one inside, right? So V2 now equal to, you say V2 equal to Y. Calculate chi of Y times nu of Y. Or new star of Y, and then apply the new approach. Is this clear? Then, so how we do it? Yeah, which coordinate system you insert? You use to insert chi. It doesn't matter at the end. Right? The end result is the same. Okay? But you can make your life simple by choosing an appropriate coordinate system to insert chi, and we made our life simple. Simple by using the W2 coordinate system. Because in the W2 coordinate system, the V2 was completely independent of all everything else, all the moment, right? Because the V2 was to be inserted at V2 equal to 0. Okay, so all the del I V2 terms had dropped out. Right? Here you see that there is a del U V2, del Y V2, that have to keep, but eventually that cancels.
The dy bar
always remains outside. The dy bar freely commutes. Whether chi you put inside dy bar or outside dy bar, it makes no difference. Because chi has no c bar, right?
Right.
So dy bar you can put either outside or inside, it makes no difference. Okay, it's a dy which makes a difference. If you put it inside, you get one answer. If you put it outside, you get another answer. But at the same time, this factor is also different, right? This is 0 if you put inside, it's non-zero if you put outside. And these two effects are exactly cancel. Anyway, so the net absolute is that this result that I have written here is correct. You may arrive in different ways, right? But this is what you have. Okay, and you have to proceed by analyzing this. So now we will go to step 2, which is the wrong step. We take the wrong step. Step u are equal to 0. So if you said u are equal to 0, then of course these terms disappear here. We are putting chi of 0, mu of 0. But this is something you have already calculated, right? Chi of y, u star of y, you have already calculated. So the same formula you want here. Okay, except that k is equal to minus k. So what you get is beta of the result. And now you see that to get a beta of beta bar from this expansion, the only this is the only source of beta over beta bar, right? These are also one. So you basically pick beta of beta times beta over beta bar. Okay? That's the only term which can survives. So beta of beta bar. And then we have C bar C V tilde sigma minus I V tilde plus I by 2 V dot psi. This is what you get from chi 0, v 0, and then I have to just write this. Is this clear? Okay, so I just picked sub from the previous result. You replace V by V star, V tilde by V tilde star everywhere. Okay, and then here, the plus I by 2k got to the minus I by 2k because previously it was minus I k, k dot x, here is I k dot x. Okay. And now, of course, there is no further dy, dy bar or d0, d0 bar, so C bar C is there. Okay, it's hanging around, and hence these terms also. And earlier, there is a B bar which is removed. The C is from here and that is 0. Okay, that's not there anymore. So this is the unintegrated 0 to k bodies. Okay, this is integrated 0 to k bodies. Okay, because this, from this you remove the BB bar, the CC bar. From this you have not removed C bar. Okay, this is unintegrated 0 to k bodies. That's why this is inserted at a fixed point 0, this is integrated. So now there are several simplifications. First, you see that this term cannot contribute. There are several ways to see this. First of all, the high charge is not conserved, right? root of 5 charge has to add up to 0 on the totals. This is the only term that carries it to be 5, right? There is nothing else that carries it to be 5. So this vanishes, that any polarization path involving this vanishes, that is a 5 charge. Yeah, that's another word saying the host charge is not concept, right? 2 B's and 1 C. Right? Or you can say the eta charge as I eta charge is not concept. This is a small inverse space, that should be equal number of I's and eta's on the totals. That's also not true, right? As you know, single. These are all there. So all charge conservation gets violated. So this doesn't contribute, so that makes that even simpler. The second observation is that after you have evaluated this, since there is no polarization tensor or anything, the only vector that is available here is k. That's the only Lorentz vector. Right? You can see. So after you have evaluated all the polarization functions, the result can only depend on k square. That's the Lorentz vector. There's no k dot epsilon or anything that you can construct. The result has to depend on k square. And k square is 0. Because we are supposed to use on-shell k, okay? On-shell vortex operators, where on-shell-less is defined at a tree level, okay? Because you are calculating one loop mass normalization. So k square is 0 because you are using on-shell vortex operator. Is that clear? So which basically means that anything that contains a k cannot contribute. Right? We might as well say k equal to 0. Okay? Because, for example, this k dot psi, right? How can it contribute? Okay? It can contribute because there is a k dot psi here, and then there is a k dot psi here. The psi contraction will give you some eta value. Okay? That will give a k square. Okay? But that, of course, you know it is in 0. Okay? Similarly, so this term doesn't contribute. We have it will be ik dot x, it will be minus ik dot x. Okay? The two-point function will involve something raised to power k square. Yeah, and again k square is 0. So you might as well set k equal to 0 for the beginning. Okay, that answer is the same as what we have got from this after setting k square equal to 0. Yeah, so this z1 minus z2, z1 minus z2 to the power k square, right? But k square is 0.
Yes.
Right? So that's the equivalent to take to identity operator.
Yes.
Right? And taking that. Okay, so once you have said k square equal to 0, you might as well say k equal to 0, right? Because k has something to contract with. Right? So there's no k dot epsilon, right? For which k square equal to 0 would have been different from k equal to 0. So that makes life very simple. So we have to evaluate if it is a d tau bar, which is dy, which is dy bar, d tau bar, c bar c, e tilde, 0, and then e tilde star. And let me just again remind you what it is and it is a star of that. This is for all four model. Because it will give us some insight into what we are going to write next. So this is del xm psi p, sorry, lambda p, lambda p, and it is a star is del xm bar. So I'll just argue that this is at 0 and then I'll solve. The idea is that this whole is a factor I'll tell them.
Epsilon infinity q.
Epsilon m bar r. Now, let's introduce two operators, p plus and p minus. So this will take to be p minus pi by 2, sigma 6, sigma 4 alpha, and p minus will equal to be pi by 2, sigma 6 c, sigma 4. And for alpha, I'll choose equal to I by 2, I1 plus I2. Okay, and for beta, I'll choose equal to minus I by 2, I1 plus I2. Okay, that's conjugate solution. Alpha can have two possible values, right? One of which corresponds to the I by 2, phi 1 plus phi 2. Other one is equal to minus I by 2, phi 1 plus
I2,
right?
And
no. The point is, this star is not, see, del bar will make it into anti-holomorphic. You don't want to go to, so it's a holomorphic. Right? But this index, okay, this is the SU3 index, right, which becomes conjugate. Okay, is this notation clear? Yes, and maybe I said say S alpha, sigma alpha, sigma 4 alpha. Like alpha and beta indices are chosen so that these are sigma 4 alpha and sigma 4 beta. Then the OP, P plus of Z, P minus of W, and this is very fine, it's 1 over Z minus 1. The other important point is that both of these operators are GSU. Okay, this is manifestly GSU. It's minus half picture, sigma 6, sigma 4 alpha. Okay, or the GSU operator in the matter sector. Here is plus phi by 2, that makes it GSU odd in the Gauss sector. It's also GSU odd in the matter sector because there is sigma 6 c. Okay, so as a whole, this is GSU, this is GSU in the matter Gauss sector. So their correlation functions are supposed to be single value. Right, after you have summed over the structure. So consider this following structure, this is periodic on the forwards. Okay, the function of zeta. Okay, even though it has spin fields, okay, it is periodic on the forwards because you have sum over spin strength. Okay, so what happens is that as you move z by tau or by 1, right, it takes result from one spin structure and makes it the result from the other spin structure. Right? Moving a spin field around this changes the spin structure. But the sum is invariant. Okay, that's periodic in zeta and w. Now, as it, let's look at it as a function of z, and it's easy to verify that this object it's easy to verify that this one has no singularity. Either are within or within a star. If you use the orbifold example, it's clear. Right? There's no psi m here, right? So in the spin field has no singularity with del x. But this you can see from a general, even if you don't have the orbifold example, but a general conformal field theory. Right? Just by using general identities in conformal field theory, you can check that a correlation function of this kind has no singularity as a function of center. Near other zero. Is this statement clear? And it's clear for these particular choices. Yeah, but it's also general. Of course, near D it has no singularity. And it has no C. So the only singularity of this is at Z equal to 1. Right? So this is the periodic function on the torus. Periodic. They are basically a double periodic function because torus is has double periodicity, right? And the periodic function of Z on the torus with a single pole as an equal. And now we can use a general lesser, okay, from theory of Riemann surfaces. Okay, but you don't even have to do it in the Riemann surface, it's a simple lesser from the electric part. That general lesser is that there is no such function. Okay, such a function simply doesn't exist, which is doubly periodic, which has periodic under z goes to z plus 1 and z goes to z plus tau, and which also has a single pole at z equal to 1.
This statement will carry over to Riemann matching.
Yeah, I think this is a special case for Riemann matching. The minimum number of poles you need is 2. Okay, if you have a torus, a double periodic function of the torus, you need at least 2 poles. Okay. So this means what? This means that the function must be constant, right? That it has no, it really has no pole at z equal. So this means that the residue at z equal to w must vanish. So inside this correlation function, right? This correlation function is constant, right? So if one can translate it easily, this means the residue at z equal to w must vanish, right? That the pole which looks like a pole is not really a pole. Okay? So residue at z equal to w must vanish, but what is the residue at z equal to w? Right? At z equal to w, the p plus z p minus w is 1 over z minus 1, right? So the residue is exactly that correlation function. So residue is exactly E tau bar C bar C between the 0 and between the star. Okay, so that shows that this is 0. So if you really start doing a calculation with two zero picture harmonic operators, then the result is identically zero. Okay, you will conclude that there is no Bastion operation. Okay. So next time we'll do the correct calculation by taking here v or two, not equal to zero. And you will find it easier to calculate the difference between that and this calculation, where we have said v are equal to zero, where the difference will be total derivative, okay, which can be easily analyzed. There will be Del Z term and V all is no longer 0, right? See, here I have said V all equal to 0, right? So V all will no longer be 0. So you have to calculate the difference between chi of V all minus chi of 0, right? And also insert this Del Z.
Exactly,
yeah. So this argument will not hold exactly.